Did you know that there was once a female Egyptian pharaoh who was erased from history? Hello and welcome to World History Encyclopedia. My name is Kelly and today's video is all about Hatshepsut, the first woman to rule ancient Egypt with the full authority of a pharaoh. Don't forget, the easiest way to support us is by giving this video a thumbs up, subscribing to our channel, and hitting that bell icon for notifications so you don't miss out on any new uploads. World History Encyclopedia is a non-profit organisation and you can find us on Patreon, a brilliant site where you can support our work and receive exclusive benefits in return. Your support helps us create videos twice a week, so make sure to check it out via the pop-up in the top corner of the screen or via the Patreon link down below. Hatshepsut, whose name means foremost of noble women, or she is first among noble women, was the first woman to rule in Egypt with the full authority of a male. She began as regent for her stepson, Thutmose III, and presented herself as a woman, but later she chose to depict herself as a man, something that we will get into very soon. Other women before her ruled Egypt, like Merneith in the early dynastic period, circa 3000 BCE, and Sobek-Nefru, who reigned in the Middle Kingdom, between circa 1807 and 1802 BCE. But what makes Hatshepsut even more fascinating is the lengths to which her successors, most likely Thutmose III, took to remove her from history. So who was Hatshepsut and why did the rulers following her death want to rid themselves and their region of all memory of her? Let's find out. Hatshepsut was the daughter of Pharaoh Thutmose I and his great wife Ahmose. During this time, it was common for pharaohs to have multiple wives. And to his second wife, Mutnofret, Thutmose I had a son, Thutmose II, who was the heir to the throne. The Egyptians liked to keep the royal bloodlines pure, but not too pure, which is why pharaohs had children with more than one wife. And so to keep it all nice and close and in the family, before Hatshepsut was 20 years old, she was married to her half-brother, Thutmose II. Hatshepsut and Thutmose II only had one child, Neferu-Ra, and with a second wife, Thutmose II had a son, Thutmose III, who was named as his father's successor. At this point, Hatshepsut was elevated to the position of God's wife of Amun, which was the highest honour a woman could have in Egypt, second only to being queen. The position began as an honorary title for an upper-class woman who would assist the high priest of Amun at the Great Temple of Amun at Karnak. In the Middle Kingdom, it became an honorific given to the wife or daughter of a king. And then by the New Kingdom, the woman holding the position wielded significant religious and political power. The position of God's wife of Amun in the New Kingdom came with great power, more so than many queens could wield, and they could dictate policy and were to preside over the festivals to Amun. Hatshepsut would have been considered as the consort to the god Amun, and this obviously raised her status to that of a divine being, although the exact details of this position are unclear. While Thutmose III was still only a child, Thutmose II died, and Hatshepsut became regent, which was a common role for women to claim when the heir to the throne was not yet old enough to rule. She was meant to control the affairs of Egypt until her stepson came of age, but 7 years after she became regent, she proclaimed herself Pharaoh of Egypt and took all the royal titles and names. These titles were all written in the feminine grammatical form, but she began to depict herself as a male pharaoh. The pharaohs of ancient Egypt were believed to be the son of the god Horus, so perhaps it was to follow this tradition and help keep Maat, which was the harmony and order of the region, that she depicted herself in the regalia of a male, fake beard included. As regent, Hatshepsut depicted herself behind Thutmose, but once she had herself made pharaoh, her statues were all built in royal grandeur, with Thutmose III rendered smaller and either behind or below her, as a clear indication of his status. Technically, Thutmose III was the king, and he was still referred to as such, but only in name, as Hatshepsut clearly felt like she had just as much right to rule Egypt as any man. Keep in mind that she wasn't trying to fool anyone, and although she took lengths to legitimize her rule by depicting herself as any other male pharaoh would, any text about her continued to use female grammar. As pharaoh, Hatshepsut married her daughter to her stepson, and then bestowed upon Neferu-Ra the position of God's wife of Amun. So even if she was forced to give up her power to Thutmose III, at least she would be both his stepmother and mother-in-law, and her daughter held one of the most powerful positions in Egypt. Hatshepsut didn't stop there though, and claimed that she was the daughter of the god Amun, who had appeared to her mother in the form of Thutmose I, which made her a demigoddess. Hatshepsut focused on building projects and repairing older buildings, temples, and monuments across Egypt, and sending out a number of military and trading campaigns. The exact nature of the military campaigns is unclear, but they may have been launched for a couple of reasons: to uphold the tradition of the pharaoh as a warrior king, as a continuation of Thutmose I's campaigns, which would have also helped to legitimize her rule further, or they could have been fairly provoked. Either way, these campaigns moved into the regions of Syria and Nubia. There was one man, Senenmut, who had a mysterious relationship with the queen, and who's thought to have been Hatshepsut's secret lover. He rose to prominence in Hatshepsut's court from an unremarkable family, and became the chief steward of Amun, among other titles, such as steward of the royal ship and chief architect. Senenmut was in charge of all of Hatshepsut's greatest building projects, most notably her grand temple at Deir el-Bahari. Both the number and quality of the building projects completed during the reign of a pharaoh attested to their prosperity, and Hatshepsut completed many of great beauty, suggesting a wealth of resources at her disposal. The best example of this, aside from her lavish building projects, is her expedition to the land of Punt. Ever since the Middle Kingdom of Egypt, Punt had been a trading partner of Egypt, but trading expeditions were always time-consuming and expensive, and trade with Punt had fallen off. The trading expedition that Hatshepsut sent to Punt was an incredibly lavish one, which again was a testament to her prosperous reign. The account of this expedition with an accompanying inscription was engraved on the walls of her temple at Deir el-Bahari, which details the luxury goods they received from Punt, including ebony and ivory, cinnamon wood, eye cosmetics, apes, dogs, monkeys, and panther skins. Her temple at Deir el-Bahari is considered one of the most elegant temples in Egypt and is still a popular site to visit today. The temple looks as if it emerged from the rock face behind it, and trees that were brought from Punt were replanted here, and are the first known trees to be successfully transplanted from one nation to another. The fossilized stumps of these trees can still be seen today. The only pharaoh that built to the same grand scale as Hatshepsut was Ramesses II, and no one after him matched it except for her. If her lavish building projects were not enough, Hatshepsut also had two enormous obelisks raised at Karnak. While Hatshepsut put her time and wealth into trade and building projects, Thutmose III wasn't just waiting around for his time to properly rule Egypt. No, Hatshepsut kept him busy on numerous military campaigns. She gave him command of Egypt's armies, perhaps hoping that he would get injured or die at some point in a conflict, but it's been suggested that he survived her reign by making himself useful as a general and staying out of her way. In circa 1457, Thutmose III ended a rebellion at the Syrian city of Kadesh, known as the Battle of Megiddo, on a campaign possibly anticipated and commissioned by Hatshepsut, and then her name simply vanished from the historical record. Until only recently, the cause of death for Hatshepsut was unknown, but now we have a pretty good idea. Zahi Hawass, a renowned Egyptologist, claimed in 2006 that he had found the mummy of Hatshepsut in Cairo Museum's holdings. The mummy was lying next to a box that had Hatshepsut's name on it, and inside the box there was a tooth. After examining the mummy and the tooth, it was clear to Hawass that the tooth fit the mummy, and so it is believed that Hatshepsut died in her 50s from an abscess after having a tooth extracted. Her stepson, Thutmose III, became known as the Napoleon of ancient Egypt for his great military successes. And 20 years after her death, widespread destruction of Hatshepsut occurred. Not only that, but Thutmose III backdates his rule to the death of his father, and all that Hatshepsut accomplished in her 20 years as pharaoh is attributed to Thutmose III instead. Her name and images were erased from evidence in an attempt to completely remove her from Egypt's history. Later scribes don't even mention Hatshepsut, and many of the great building projects she made happen were often claimed to be the works of later pharaohs. The wreckage of her statues and inscriptions was dumped near her mortuary temple, Deir el-Bahari, but it was surviving inscriptions inside the temple that confused and confounded later historians, most notably Jean-François Champollion. Champollion was the man who deciphered hieroglyphics using the Rosetta Stone, which had three languages on it: Greek, Demotic, and Egyptian hieroglyphics. If you want to learn more about the decipherment and importance of the Rosetta Stone, you can head to our video all about it. Hatshepsut was depicted as a male, but continued to use hieroglyphics indicating a female ruler in her inscriptions, and it truly had Champollion stumped. There have been a bunch of theories as to why Thutmose III would want to remove his stepmother from history, but the most likely reason was because of her unconventional reign, which departed from the long tradition of Egyptian kingship. Since the pharaoh's number one job was to keep Maat, which was harmony and balance, having a woman in a man's position would have disrupted that balance. The pharaoh was also a role model for Egyptians, and it was likely that Thutmose III didn't want other women looking at Hatshepsut as an inspiration and attempting to follow in her footsteps. The Egyptians believed that you live only as long as your name is remembered, and this belief is exemplified in Hatshepsut. She was erased and forgotten as the new kingdom of Egypt continued. But once her name was found and reconciled with her image and prosperous reign, she gradually came back to life and assumed her rightful place as one of the greatest pharaohs in Egypt's history. Do you agree with the common thought that Hatshepsut was removed to stop other women following in her footsteps? Let us know what you think in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel so you don't miss out on any new videos. This video was brought to you by World History Encyclopedia. For more great articles and interactive content, head to our website via the link below. If you like my shirt, you can find this design and a bunch more in our shop at worldhistory.store, or you can find the link for it under our merch tab down below. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you soon with another video.